life. Whether you're ready or not, sometimes it's rough. And it takes all that you've got, but he's been here. Just waiting for you to knock, to take his hand.
Hi, welcome to Life on the Rock, and tonight we have the organization Catholic Youth Summer Camp. We have Aaron Richards, Bob Moraine, and Dan DeMatte, and they're going to talk about their summer camp outside of Columbus, Ohio, and share their faith with us tonight. Good to see you, Doug.
You too, Padre.
Speaking of camps, tell us about yours.
What's up? Our first official battle-ready training camp begins next week. We've got young men coming from California to Florida, Texas, Minnesota, Michigan, South Dakota, Missouri, Nebraska, all these different states. And these guys are coming for a battle-ready training camp. And it's a little bit something new, I think, for a lot of people. It's kind of spiritual warfare type approach and physical self-defense. We're going to teach them physical self-defense well. Right. So we've got 13 to 17-year-olds, and it's a good group of guys. It's going to be a lot of fun. So I'm asking for prayers, though, praying for these guys, because we focus a lot on, you know, at Camp Gargano, which is named after the shrine of St. Michael the Archangel in Gargano, Italy. We focus a lot on the spiritual warfare aspect, especially of a man. And we men need to realize that our job as protectors, providers, defenders, in our families, our homes, father as a spiritual officer on the battlefield, as a priest, we need to be stepping that up. And so it's a big encouragement. So I'm asking for prayers for all these young men coming.
And really, we're talking about evangelization. Right?
Absolutely.
The popes, recent popes, have talked about this. Yeah. John Paul talked about it, Benedict, and of course Pope Francis. And I wanted to talk about I've been mentioning on different shows about his recent address at Pentecost to ecclesial groups, and he took questions from the audience from these different ecclesial movements, and they asked the Holy Father, said, "How do you evangelize?" Mm. Right? And I'm sure many of you are wondering that at home. You hear it all the time. We must evangelize, and this is Pope Francis's answer to that question. He gives three words. He says, first, he says, Jesus. That's the most important thing. He says, if we forge ahead with our own arrangements, with other things, with beautiful things, but without Jesus, we make no headway. It does not work. So we're following Jesus's plans. We're following his direction in our life. He tells us in the gospel, without him, we can do nothing. So that's first, right? We're following disciples first, seeking his will. Second, he said, to evangelize, we must pray. He said, looking at the face of God, but above all, and this has to be with what I said earlier, realizing that he is also looking at us. So in our prayer time, realizing that God is gazing upon us, that he's looking upon us first. He's calling us to him. He says, my experience is what I feel in front of the tabernacle when I go in the evening to pray before the Lord. Sometimes I nod off for a while. This is true, for the strain of the day, more or less, makes you fall asleep. But he understands. I feel great comfort when I think of the Lord looking at me. We think we have to pray and talk. No, let the Lord look at you. You know, I remember Mother Angelica would say this so often on the show about just going and being in the presence of our Lord, you know, his presence there in the Eucharist, and go bring the body, right? Sometimes we're tired. We can't put two thoughts together, but bring the body, and the soul will follow and the mind will follow. So he said, let us think of God holding us by the hand. Then I would like to draw attention to this element, letting ourselves be led by him. We are true evangelizers when we let him guide us. And I think that is so key, that we have to have that docility to follow him, to bloom where he plants us, to do that work he gives us every day, the people he brings into our lives, the work he puts in front of us. It's true, we bring all our talents, our gifts, our ingenuity, our plans, and we try to do things as best we can and plan for the future, but it all has to be, in following the Lord and being led by him. And third, he says, witness. He said, prayer means letting ourselves be led by him, and then witness. He said, I'd like to add something, letting oneself be led by Jesus leads to the surprises of Jesus. I think we can all testify to that. We're going to be in Rio in a month, right? Yeah. So there's surprises and fulfillment, unexpected fulfillments when you follow the Lord. And we do our loudest preaching, of course, by the witness of our lives. And he says, witness that faith can only be communicated through witness, and that means love. Not only with our own ideas, but with the gospel lived out in our own lives and brought to life within us by the Holy Spirit. So it's not so much about speaking, but rather speaking with our whole lives, living consistently, the very consistency of our lives. This consistency means living Christianity as an encounter with Jesus that brings me to others. So he goes on to speak about how the church can't just be self-contained. It must get out of herself, give, reach out to the poor. And that he says in a beautiful way, he said, I'd rather the church have a few accidents by going out than just staying self-enclosed and becoming sick.
Right, you know? Worried about being so secure. And that's actually one of the, that's the key thing we focus on with our camp. And I know our guests tonight, you know, when preparing for the show, they talk a lot about that relationship with Christ. And with Battle Ready Training Camp and the things that I'm doing with Battle Ready, that is the main approach we focus on, is that prayer time with God. That true warrior, that true soldier goes before the king, just to be with the king, to learn from the king, to be guided by the king, strengthened, healed, nourished, you know, by God's grace. And it is essential. You know, but like you mentioned, Rio is coming up. You know, we're going to be going down to Brazil, and they're talking about potentially breaking the record of the, I forget what the, you know, massive, you know, gazillion people that were in the Philippines. Right. They're talking about that record potentially being broken, because we're going down to the home territory of the Holy Father, Pope Francis.
It's the largest Catholic continent, largest Catholic country, and the Pope is from that continent. Right, so right. It's going to be big.
It is going to be big. And all you out there watching, you know, every time you come here to EWTN, especially Life on the Rock, you get all the information necessary for World Youth Day. We're going to be down there, as Father, you mentioned, just in about a month, because you all know that we here in the Rock House are World Youth Day Central. And as you know, just recently we had a guest on our show, Father Matt Lowry, and his crew, his clan, his horde of conquering individuals from, compadres, that's it, down in Arizona. They were on the show not too long ago, and we have a video. We've been showing some videos of them preparing for their trip to Rio. Mm-hmm. And here's another one from Father Matt Lowry and his crew down in Arizona.
Before we go, everyone, I think what's most important on a pilgrimage is to really lift it up to the Lord in prayer. And there's the World Youth Day prayer, so I'd like for us to pray this together as a group before we go. Okay? In the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Together. Oh, Father, you sent your eternal Son to save the world. You chose men and women through him, with him, and in him, to proclaim the good news to all nations. Grant us the graces necessary so that joy may shine in the faces of all young people, the joy of being, by the power of the Holy Spirit, the evangelist that the church needs in the third millennium. O Christ, Redeemer of humanity, the image of your open arms on the top of Corcovado welcomes all people. In your Paschal offering, you brought us by the Holy Spirit to an encounter of sonship with the Father. Young people who are fed by Eucharist, hear you in your word and me too as their brother, need your infinite mercy to run the paths of the world missionary disciples of the new evangelization. O Holy Spirit, love of the Father and the Son, with the splendor of your truth and the fire of your love, send your light to all young people so that driven by their experience of World Youth Day, they may bring to the four corners of the world faith, hope, and charity, becoming great builders of a culture of life and peace and catalysts of a new world. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
That is beautiful. I know I'm getting excited about it. And I just want to close with a thought from our Holy Father in that message I was giving you. He talked about, you know, prayer and being led by Jesus, being a witness, and going out. He says that we live in a time of crisis, an economic crisis, but also a crisis of culture where the human person is impoverished in many different dimensions. He says, at this time of crisis, we cannot be concerned solely with ourselves, withdrawing into loneliness, discouragement, and a sense of powerlessness in the face of problems. Please, do not withdraw into yourselves. This is a danger. We shut ourselves up in the parish, with our friends, within the movement, with the like-minded. But do you know what happens? When the church becomes closed, she becomes an ailing church. She falls ill. So he says, go out, and he says, create a culture of encounter, of friendship, of relationships. Create a culture of encounter with Christ. And he says, go out in search of people that are not like-minded, you know, and bring new people into the fold, into the fold that Christ is the good shepherd and wants to guide all of us. Go in search of people in the world. And that's what he's telling us to do. So be led. Ask God to inspire you, to use you as his instrument to bring people to know him in a deeper way. Well, we're gonna take a quick break. We'll be back with our guest tonight, the Catholic Youth Summer Camp. So don't go away. Back in a moment.
Welcome back to Life on the Rock, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Doug Berry, along with Father Mark. We are the Rock House Compadres. That's an official title, by the way. We're trying to get a U.S. patent on it and make sure nobody steals it from us. You're in the Rock House, where the day of night, time, and season are always the same because it's the mystery of God working through the Rock House. We're hidden high up in the mountains. It took these guys several days to get here. We had to blindfold them and cover their heads in bags and such to make sure, because the enemies of truth are always after us, and we've got to make sure we're around so we can keep broadcasting this message throughout the world, because we know this is going throughout the world, from the Pacific Rim, Ireland, and beyond. Even gulags in Russia are getting this message, mm-hmm. if they have internet. Gentlemen, good to have you on the show.
It's good to be here.
Bob,
be
here. Aaron,
Mark,
yes. And Dan. There you go, buddy. All right. And we are ready for battle, ladies and gentlemen. This is the Catholic Summer Youth Camp. You have this incredible thing. Bob, tell us a little bit about, if you can. I just have to have the sword here.
It's okay.
Because it's like spiritual warfare, isn't it?
It is like spiritual
and
warfare.
And you guys are deep entrenched in it. You're doing these camps where you're getting hundreds and hundreds of kids every summer to come out and go through these week-long sessions where they're enjoying the adventure of God, the adventure of faith. And that is spiritual battle, because the devil's trying to breed and encourage despair and discouragement and loneliness and boredom and kind of an insignificant attitude towards the faith and kind of a doldrum sort of thing. But that's not what this camp is all about.
It's not at all what this camp is
all
about.
Right, tell us about it a little bit.
This camp is about adventure. In fact, our tagline is live the adventure. Live the adventure of our faith, because our faith is not boring. And in the culture in which we live today, oftentimes I think young people, particularly young Catholic people, have this misconception that our faith is boring. And in fact, it's a great adventure. And so we try to show them that through high adventure activities throughout the course of the day, but more importantly, to present to them the great adventure of our faith.
Mm-hmm. And I like the way you refer to it as the great adventure of our faith. I know we were before the show, Aaron, we were talking about this a little bit. Why do you see it as an adventure?
Well, our faith, the adventure that entails it, it encompasses every aspect of our lives. You know, we can't be boring people. God doesn't call us to be boring saints. God calls us to encounter the world and to make a difference, to make an impact in every area where we are well suited. Mm-hmm. You know, we have this misconception again, as Bob said, where oftentimes we think that to be a faithful person, we have to kind of recede into ourselves, but that's not the reality that God calls us to. He calls us to go out. Mm-hmm. And to spread the faith through our work and through our action.
You know, you think of the relationship of love when it comes to courting your wife, you know, and you know, you've been married 15 years, you said,
yeah,
and
yeah.
You've each 5 years to your yeah. wives, and mm-hmm. you all have children, and I've been married 23 years and children, and you know, when we courted our wives, when you want to win their heart, there's this something that has to come out of you, right, to really let her know, you're everything to me, And you know, like Dan, do you remember any crazy things you did?
My wife's love story. We were on a reality TV show actually on A&E.
Oh, really?
God or the Girl. So that was pretty crazy.
Oh, that was you.
That was me.
Okay,
I saw
commercials for the program. I never actually watched it.
Yeah, so I say I was called a God through the girl. And,
okay.
So we were pretty crazy, but.
I think that's a lot of truth in that, though. When I talk to young men in discerning, and they just have a sense that marriage is going to bring them closer to God.
Yep.
And that's the whole point, right? That's what our vocation should do. It's all about a path to God. So.
Yeah, definitely. I remember I had a woman come up to me after I proposed to my wife, and she said to Amber, she said, "So you're the reason he's not becoming a priest." She's like, "I like to believe that was God's will." But
the idea of that love does kind of prompt us to do things that the world doesn't understand. As Spock would say from Star Trek, you know, it's not logical, you know, that we do crazy things out of love. But shouldn't that then be also what our faith is about? I mean, Dan, when it comes to what you're trying to encourage and the message through this camp is the adventure, that high octane
yep.
relationship with God that surpasses all and everything of this world. I mean, speak on that if you can.
Yeah, no, I think our culture actually wants to crush our youth. The plague of apathy is everywhere. It's amazing. When people ask me, what's the hardest challenge in youth's lives today? It's not the typical things. I think it's apathy. Mm. Teenager after teenager after teenager just doesn't care about anything. They're slothful and they lack joy, they lack passion, they lack adventure. And so, the mission of our camp is to say, listen, Jesus Christ brings you the greatest adventure of your life. He brings you the greatest joy, the greatest love story, the greatest battle, the greatest life you could ever imagine. I love to think of just the Acts of the Apostles. You know, you picture the Acts of the Apostles, and their life was insane, right? They encountered the living God, and as a result of that encounter, their life was the greatest adventure you could imagine. And that's the exact same adventure he wants us to have. It's not, our lives are no different than Peter and Andrew and James and John. Our call is no different. God is calling us to the same mission,
you know,
as he did 2,000 years ago.
You mentioned about the apostles, and I think there's something really awesome about what happens to the apostles before and after Pentecost. Mm-hmm. It's a great example of when the Spirit of God is working in us yeah. and when it's not, when we're closed off to it or when we're open to it. Because here they were hiding for fear of their lives yeah. until the tongues of fire on the head, and then the doors burst open, and they're out there in the streets in different languages, you know, and 11 of the 12 die, you know, they tried to kill John, stuck him on an island, you know, but the idea that when the Holy Spirit infects us, you feel unstoppable, right? So I mean, I know that's one of the things you think about with the camp, as we talked beforehand, you're trying to convey these messages of that Spirit of God working. How do you do that in your camp program, Bob?
Well, I think that, you know, first of all, I think it's important to say that the three of us, I think, share this common spirituality that is inspired by our patron, St. John Bosco, who, of course, you know, had a heart for young people. And so there's a fact among us that, you know, we feel called to love young people where they are. and to bring them to Christ and to draw them more fully into the life of the church. And so I think that, you know, the Spirit is working in and through all of us, no matter who we are, in different and unique ways. Mm-hmm. And certainly He has equipped us collectively to help young people through Catholic Youth Summer Camp to grow in their appreciation for the church and for Christ.
All right. A little bit of background about it. Aaron, how long has this camp program been in existence?
This summer we celebrate our 13th year of existence, and we've grown from our first year having 64 students in a single session. This year we will have close to 700 over 7 weeks.
Mm. Wow, and this is, and where are you located at?
We're located in Central Ohio. We actually operate in four different campsites that we're renting currently. And our dream, which is quickly becoming a reality, is to eventually own our own site.
Mm-hmm. All right. And the camp, I mean, Dan, a little bit about the details. When they get to the camp, they're going to be there for a week. What sorts of things will they experience? Oh,
yeah. So we're a high adventure camp that seeks to build a high adventure of faith. And so, you know, we have jet skis, water tubing, Zorbs, which are just a big, huge inflatable hamster balls that you push kids down a mountain and you hope that they're all right, and we have paintballing, high ropes, low ropes,
rock climbing.
Yeah, we have rock climbing, and we have religious at every single week of camp, and so we have religious sisters and habits on the jet skis. And
are they in the Zorb thing, the hamster ball?
We've had a priest praying the Magnificat while going down the Zorb. It was great. I think Father Mark wants to come out this summer and get on the jet skis. So yeah, well, do you think Mother Angelica would be up for that?
Unlikely.
Yeah.
She'd pray about it though.
But yeah, so you know, you can expect the adventure activities, be it the mud pit or the slip and slide, but you're also going to expect a high adventure faith where we present the faith in its fullness. The Catholic faith is so vibrant and beautiful, and so we provide, you know, we just show the beauty of Catholicism with daily Mass, adoration, confession, lots of worship, just sacred art and deep prayer. And so
tell us about the adoration. How does that, the benediction and just a prayerful, like a holy hour, or how does that work?
Yeah, definitely. We, our goal is, the main goal of our camp is that kids will come and encounter Jesus. And so we do a lot to prepare them with the high adventure activities and breaking down the rocks that sometimes guard their hearts. Mm-hmm. But then ultimately we put them before Jesus, and in the silence, that's where you hear His voice. And, you know, I think our goal is that at some point at camp, a young person will hear Jesus say, "I love you, and I'm calling you to follow me and to give me everything."
Yeah, I think that's so true about the sacraments. I've seen that at seminary. We'd have this big, like a Youth 2000 event. Like one year it was like 1,800 when I was there. And it was just so true that they'd have adoration, lots of confessions, lots of preaching, the Mass, and just great things happen. It's like you just bathe them in the sacraments, yeah. And God works through that in such a powerful way.
It makes our work easy.
Yeah.
Yeah, you throw enough grace at them, and
you really can't go wrong.
It starts to soak in a little
right.
bit.
Yeah.
All right, that's, we're going to run to a break here, and we'll be back more with these three gentlemen on fire for the faith, the summer camps out in Ohio, and get a little more detail what goes on there. And if you're interested on coming on out or supporting their work, we'll give you information on that as well. Don't go away. We'll be back after this. Welcome back to Life on the Rock. I'm Doug Barry, along with Father Mark, and our guest tonight from the Catholic Youth Summer Camps out in Ohio. We talked before in the first segment there about love and how love makes us do crazy things. You told us you were on a show. That's crazy, but that's good, All right, Aaron, any crazy stories about courting your wife?
Well, actually, my family is completely wrapped up in Catholic Youth Summer Camp. I met my wife my first day at camp in 2001. Okay. So we are the first CYSC vocation story.
Amen. So did you get married at the camp then?
I really pushed for that.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, I don't know if that's in the rite of marriage or not. Yeah,
a couple logistical details there. Yeah. But what crazy things did you do out of love for your wife as you were courting her?
Well, I think the craziest thing we do and continue to do is our work in ministry together. Mm. We are raising a family, and I'm working in full-time.
No, that's not, I'm sorry. That's not the story the audience wants to hear. All the women out there right now want to hear, what crazy things did you do as a man for her specifically? Like for my wife, before we got married, I when she was living with her parents, I went out to the house at 5 a.m. and wrapped her fence with red and white streamers and made giant red cardboard hearts for St. Valentine's Day and left flowers. So when she looked out the window, she looked like
the guy that makes us all look bad.
Candyland, you know? drove my mother-in-law crazy at the time, but you know, but things like that. We'll get to you later, Bob. But what about you, Aaron? What crazy thing did you do for
her? I suppose the craziest thing we probably did was on the night of our engagement. I am our camp musician. I lead our music ministry, so I kind of prepared my church at St. Agatha Church in Columbus, and we went and I serenaded her with some great music that I had prepared before in my engagement.
Okay, that's nice. That's good. That's good. Does that pass, ladies? Is that good?
Is that good enough? I hope.
Okay. The ladies in the audience, you're happy about that. Okay.
If you would have been there. you would have realized.
He serenades me, and it's just wonderful. Yeah.
It's a great serenader.
Wow. Okay. All right. So, but back to the camp. We talked earlier about, in the previous segment, about faith formation. That's a big part of it, because there's a lot of camps out there, you know, Bob, that go on and on about activities, and you guys got great activities. I mean, Zorb balls on jet skis while tap dancing on a waterfall or something
right,
like that.
Right. That's exactly it.
You got great, but it's great and exciting stuff. But obviously the faith part is such a key part as well. Mm-hmm. Faith formation, evangelization, discipleship, vocation, support system. Talk a little bit about that if you guys could.
Well, I think you've tapped into that. I mean, clearly young people come to the camp because of the great activities. That's our hook. You know, when you walk into a classroom at a Catholic school and, you know, a sixth grade boy sees jet skis on the promo video, they want to go to camp. But that's not why we have camp. We have camp to help young people grow in their faith. And so we actually have a six-year faith rotation, if you will, in terms of talking about different aspects of our faith. So if a kid comes to camp from the time they're in sixth grade through 12th grade, they're going to hear a different message. This year, our faith theme is on discipleship. And, you know, other years, we talk about the Blessed Virgin. We talk about the Creed. We talk about, you know, all these different aspects of our faith and help young people to better understand them more deeply, because mm-hmm. we don't presume to be introducing them, you know, for the first time to these faith themes, but to help them grow in them more fully and more deeply so that they have a personal experience of that, and so they have a deeper understanding of it as well.
So a little different theme each year.
Absolutely.
Overall, but you're still mm-hmm. addressing a number of basic catechesis points. And of course, prayer, the sacraments, right. Adoration, the sacraments are key, confessions mm-hmm. and the Mass and so forth. Yeah. It supports vocation system, though, too. Any stories about people come out other than your marriage vocation? Which is funny, because a lot of people don't think of marriage as the vocation.
Right.
You know, but when you ask, you know about vocation crisis, you know, we have a vocation crisis, we do, in marriage as well. Mm-hmm. People not understanding fully what marriage should be, and a lot of them having a hard time with where their formation's been at. Yeah. What kind of stories, you know, Dan, do you got about the support of vocation and formation?
Yeah, I mean, we just have seen a lot of young men before the Blessed Sacrament just hear God place more of a deep desire on their heart to pursue the priesthood. We've seen young ladies, you know, go to different convents around the world and discern the religious life. And, you know, I think the most beautiful thing that we witness at camp is we bring in different religious orders and priests and seminarians. And so the seminarians are actually counselors at camp every week, and we have seminarians on our staff. And so, you know, it's great to see a seminarian on stage doing a drama or giving a talk, but then also out there with a paintball gun and playing ultimate frisbee and jumping in the mud pit. And so it just brings holiness and regular life into one life, so that it's not, you know, our goal in fostering vocations is seek holiness, seek the universal call to holiness, seek a life of mission. And if you're seeking holiness and you're seeking mission, then at some point God's going to say, this is how you're going to seek holiness and how you're going to seek your mission.
Right, right.
And those seminarians are from the Josephinum?
Yeah, all the seminarians are from the Josephinum, the Diocese of Columbus or Archdiocese of Cincinnati.
So that's a tremendous resource for you all there. Oh, yeah. Right? Do you get some of the professors out sometimes too, or priests?
The professors of the Josephinum, yeah, we have some of the priests come out and hear confessions or celebrate Mass. We actually, the previous rector at the Josephinum was on our board of directors and still serves as a spiritual director for us.
Great. Yeah. That's terrific.
So then, Aaron, when it comes to like any kind of a structured catechesis type program, is there kind of a day-to-day sort of thing that they're going to get classes? Okay, today it's jet skiing, tomorrow it's Zorball, paintballing over here, but today, you know, Ten Commandments, and we're going to talk about this.
Sure.
I mean, is there kind of a structured catechesis
part of it? Yeah, if you wake up in the morning at Catechese Summer Camp, the first thing you do out the door is you head to daily Mass. And then after breakfast, we have four rounds of activities throughout the course of the day. And after all of our activities are over and dinner's finished, we kind of gather together for the big program aspect of our week. And every night we spend 3 hours in a session that we call club. And club is really a high energy encounter with the Lord. And we approach him in prayer with music. We preach the gospel. We encounter him on stage with skits and dramas that are performed by a well-trained staff of leaders. Who are also our activity leaders through the course of the day. So in the course of that session, they encounter the faith theme for the night. They encounter an experience of the liturgy, an experience of the sacraments. And then with that message and with that experience, we send them off to their small group, their small faith sharing groups.
I think one other thing too that that I want to highlight is that one night each week we have our monologue night. And during those monologues, our staff persons actually take on, provide a first-person monologue, if you will, of a saint of the church or a biblical character that's tied into our faith theme that week. And all the campers rotate to these different monologue sites, and they hear firsthand, if you will, from that particular person who is portraying a saint or character from sacred scripture about their encounter with Christ. And so, you know, it gives those students, it brings the scriptures alive, it makes the saints alive, brings them alive, makes them relevant, inspires them, helps them to see that, you know, there are role models that they can aspire to. And that leads into our night of adoration as well.
Right. Doug, we also, you know, we talk about the spiritual battle at hand, and so we do men's and women's every day, men's and women's sessions where we break the guys up and the girls up, and we talk to the guys about what does it mean to be a man of God living in our world today, what does it mean to be a woman of God. And so that's, you know, a daily thing that breaks up the adventure activities as well. And we also have something every day called a prayer lab where, you know, we don't want this just to be a week experience, a week encounter with Jesus. We want to teach them how to pray when they go home. And so every day, we kind of teach the young people how to foster a daily prayer life through Lectio Divina, through the rosary, through intercession and petition, through thanksgiving. And so we're teaching them the elements and the tools that they need to carry on their faith life. One of my favorite things we do at camp too is also sacred art. It's one of our activity rotations where we take a aspect of art within the church's tradition and we teach the young people why we do this, and then we allow them to actually participate in that art. So we've taught them throughout the years about iconography, about last year we made incense. We had the kids actually make incense, and we used that incense during Mass and during benediction. This year we're making candles, and we're teaching them why do we use candles. But we've done mosaics, rosaries, all kinds of Gregorian chants, just tapping into the beauty in our church and bringing it into their lives, making it real.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Why, gentlemen, has this grown from 64 members or participants your first year to now this year you're looking at reaching potentially 700?
Yeah.
I mean, other than the fact that you guys have this stunning charismatic personality just emanating
and
from all of
them. Stunning good luck.
Yeah.
Ladies, I'll leave that to you to decide. I'm not coming. But seriously, there's something about the mystery behind why these things are continuing to unfold, because you have so much faith wrapped into it, so much church, if you will, as some kids would say, I don't like going to God teens or youth group because there's too much God there. Mm-hmm. Well, you've got a lot of God, if you will, in your program,
yeah,
and it's working, and it's drawing more by now the several hundreds here. Why do you think that is?
If you feed them, they will come, right? Right? I mean, if you...
So you got good meals then, spaghetti? Yeah.
Well, and that's the thing. I think a lot of times in ministry, people try to compete with the world. Why compete with the world when we have the supernatural world? And so we provide what is supernatural through the sacraments and through the teachings of the church. And, you know, like we said a little earlier, grace, you can't beat grace. And so I think as long as we provide them with truth and we show them the joy that comes with living in a life of Christ. Over and over again, we hear kids say, I came for the jet skis, but I'm leaving in love with the Eucharist. Or I came for the jet skis, and then I encountered Jesus in the staff member's joy. Like, that our joy should be evangelistic, that our love for Christ should draw people in. And if our lives aren't drawing people in, do we really have a relationship with Jesus?
Right. Well, and we live in a culture of relativism. And, you know, the young people today are hungry for truth. And so I think that one of the reasons that we've seen growth isn't because really of anything that we are doing, but simply because of the opportunity we are giving them to hear and to embrace and to celebrate the truths of our faith, that what we are presenting to them is not gray, but it's very black and very white, and they're hungry for that. They're seeking that, they desire that. And so I think that that is why they come. And, you know, I think any of us who work with young people know that, you know, numbers increase because the young people go out and they're the ones that invite others in.
Right.
And so I think that that speaks for itself, that they're going out and saying, hey, you know, this has helped me. I appreciate this. I've had a great time. I feel part of the community of faith. I feel a part of the larger church. I understand my place and my role. I want you to come and be a part of that too. So I think that's part of our growth.
And they're going back and they're actually converting their parents as well. It's beautiful. Over and over again, we hear about campers, they go home and say, hey, Mom, Dad, why don't we go to Mass on Sunday? And they say, I want to start going. And so parents who are, you know, their lives are being changed as well through camp. It's this idea of when you set a young person on fire, and John Paul II knew this, Pope Benedict knew this, Pope Francis knows this. When you set a young person on fire, they're going to take the fire into the world. And so allow them to encounter the fire of the Holy Spirit, and the church will multiply.
Right. Now, right on. And Aaron, when you see the transformation, like over, you know, these several days, and these kids sure are coming in and they're, you know, jet skis and Zorb balls and paintball, and then this introduction to faith in a different way, in a different level, and the adventure of that. What's that like from your perspective to see that transformation happening? Because I'm sure for 13 years you've seen it, you know, many times. They come in one way and you see that change happening. What's that like?
I think that's the answer to both your last questions. You know, why are we successful and what's that change like? That change is an encounter with the Holy Spirit. You know, that's something that you can't recreate. That's something that you can't replicate. That's something that a kid's not going to have at any other place, at any other summer camp. But we have the opportunity to see the Holy Spirit actually working in the lives of these students. It's amazing. It's amazing to see the encounter that they have with the living God and the life that brings.
I think it's very humbling too, because, you know, to know that the Lord has called us and our staff and our counselors to be His instruments, to help Him to invade the lives and invade the hearts of these young people. To a place where, you know, they are on fire for their faith, and they're excited about that, and they're bold about it, and they're not afraid about it, and yet they're still a normal kid.
Yeah.
You know, we're not, you know, creating, you know, religious freaks. We're just helping good young people become good young Catholics.
Excellent. Great stuff. All right, we're going to run to a break, gentlemen. And when we come back, more on a little deeper level. And Bob's story on what he did to court his wife. We got to get something out of you, Bob, as well. So don't go away. We will be back after this.
The programming is phenomenal. The talks are great. The activities, you know, we don't have a zip line here. we don't have a Zorb. There are so many wonderful things and fun things they get to do. But the big thing that really complements what we're doing is building the relationships and leading them closer to Christ through those relationships.
We can say, hey, listen, we've got a summer camp experience for you that is just going to blow you away. And they trust in us. They go up to CYSU, they have that experience, and they come back on fire with a love for Jesus Christ.
Yes, yes, that's right. Catholic Youth Summer Camp. Yes, sign them all up. Yeah, it's a great place. Thousands and thousands need to go. Give them lots of land, lots of... Yes, Holy Father. Yes, absolutely. Oh, I'm sorry. We're back on the air. We'll talk later. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. You too. Bye. Pope says he likes the idea.
That's great. Yes.
And he wants to see it keep going. Okay. All right. All right. Now, before we get more into that phone call, Bob, what'd you do to court your wife? What kind of crazy, you know, amazing, just wild thing did you say or do to show her how she was everything to you 15 years ago?
Well, I know my wife is probably going to be really embarrassed when I tell this story, Doug, but you know, we make the presumption that it's the man who's always the courter, the pursuer. You know, the story between Stephanie and I is that she basically stalked me for a number of weeks. Actually, it's not true.
Okay.
Stephanie and I actually met at a parish where I was serving as a youth minister in Columbus, and she had volunteered to help as a small group leader. And so, you know, over the course of the first part of the year, she was, you know, helping out, and we would be talking, having our meetings afterwards. Just, you know, there started to be this kind of synergy between us, you know, as it goes. I don't know that there was really anything crazy. I just anytime we would be together, I would set up these hypothetical situations with her. You know, and I'd say things like, so, you know, if you were to marry someone, you know, what would they be like? If you were to marry someone, how many children would you have? So I set up all these crazy hypotheticals for her. And I think that it was because early on I knew that we were going to be together. Mm. In fact, from the time we were engaged until we were married, it was 4 months. So It was just one of those things where we knew.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, yeah. Love makes us do crazy things, true love, crazy things, even to the point of laying your life down for someone. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a woman who gives herself over, you know, to God to be an instrument to bring life into the world. You know, when I watched my wife give birth to our first child, I wanted to call my mom and thank her, right? Because now I knew what she went through, because I was a 10-pound baby. The women in the audience chuckle because you know what I mean by that. I mean, but the love that moves us to do incredible things, heroic things, sacrificial things is so, so important. Speaking of that, earlier you mentioned about the joy that these kids who come to your camp encounter, a certain joy, and everything is about relationship. You know, Christ comes into the world assuming human nature to really, really solidify this relationship with man. You know, I've breathed life into you, I've created you in my image and likeness, and now I assume human nature as God speaking, you know, through the second person of the Trinity, assuming human nature, and then the third person, the Holy Spirit, you know, lights the head on fire, the hair on fire, the heart burns, and go out into the world, and this relationship with God, which is so critical and essential for each of us even to have with one another. So you're saying that when they come to the camp, the relationship that they're finding with Christ comes in large part through the relationship with the counselors and the staff, and the joy that's in you Where does that joy come from, though? You're human, obviously. And right now, the audience out there is listening or watching on TV or radio or here tonight in the studio, and all the excitement of the paintball and the Zorb and all this stuff, that's all fun, but that all wears off and goes away. For all of us, it does. You know, the knees get bad. We can't quite Zorb like we used to, right? You know, so all these things fade away, but that relationship of love still needs to remain to really make it substantial and sustain us. But it's got to start, obviously, with where you're all at. So questions about this in this last segment of the show. We know that they can go to your website, which is, what is your website, Bob?
CYSC.com.
CYSC.com.
Yes, sir.
All right, they'll see it on the screen, but now for those in radio land, they can hear it now. CYSC.com. And they can get all the particulars of registration and cost and do's and don'ts and what it's going to take and who... You know, what happens if you break the laws and, you know, all the details, right?
The, all the details.
Yeah. And, but here now tonight, let's get into something deeper. All right. First of all, what drives each of you to continue day after day, year after year, to be focused on this type of ministry? This is difficult stuff. This is very difficult stuff to do. You're dealing with young lives. You've got a lot of responsibility there. Parents are handing over their children. You're all parents, so you all know. We all, four of us know, what it is to hand our children over to somebody else's care in any way, shape, or form. So what drives each of you? I'll start with you, Dan. What drives you internally to keep going day after day?
Yeah. At camp, we have a chant that we say, I'll yell or someone will yell, Jesus Christ brings us, and everyone yells, freedom, and they start jumping up and down.
It's like
and,
a William Wallace moment.
Exactly.
And actually, when
we were flying in here today, I was, exactly.
Do you want this while you speak?
I do, yeah. Yeah,
that's very natural.
I do. I love a good sword. But when we were flying here today, I was on the plane and I was asking myself in prayer, I was like, Lord, do I truly believe that you bring freedom? Do I believe in the depths of my heart that you bring freedom to the sinner, freedom to the captive? And I was thinking about our campers and the people I minister to, and I was, do I believe that Jesus Christ is going to bring them freedom? And that's what drives me. The fact that when I search my heart, I know that only Christ will bring them freedom. John Paul II, the words of his that changed my life, he said, it is Jesus, in fact, that you seek when you dream of happiness. And I know there's so many young people out there who are seeking happiness and the things of this world and empty relationships and money and success and popularity and the things, the possessions of this world. And what brings true happiness, it is Jesus. And there's a lot of times at night I pray before the Blessed Sacrament. I mean, not the Blessed Sacrament. I wish I had that in my home. the crucifix. And I just, in prayer before the crucifix, I beg Jesus to allow me to bring souls to him, to allow them to find life in him like I've found life in him.
Awesome. Awesome. Great. Freedom. That's great. Freedom. Aaron.
Yeah.
You may take the sword. If you like.
Thank you.
What is it that sustains you, drives you to keep going in this mission?
Yeah. What drives me, what sustains me, is seeing young people encounter the Holy Spirit. We are a ministry that is, we rely on the grace of the Holy Spirit in every day. You know, as you mentioned, certainly in the off season, when we are running through registration, building websites, running fundraisers. All of that difficulty, all of that anxiety goes out the window on opening day of camp. When we see those kids come, when we see that family, that community being formed for the first time that year, when we see kids who are excited to be together, excited to encounter the Lord in a new way, and then through the course of the week to see that develop, to see that crystallize, it's incredible. We're not all about a mountaintop experience at Catholic Youth Summer Camp. We build ourselves up, we create an environment where young people can encounter Jesus and where they're invited into a relationship that's gonna pay off. You know, that relationship pays off in their involvement in their family, as Dan mentioned earlier. It pays off in their involvement at their school. In the video we just saw a little earlier, it pays off in their investment in their encounter with their parish. You know, one of the most rewarding aspects of camp for me is the fact that after camp, after serving this summer for 7 weeks, I'm going to have a group of young men and young women who I'm going to get to go home to at St. Agatha Parish and minister to and minister with every week for the next year. And I know that that family is going to be on fire because they met Jesus at camp this summer.
Yeah, excellent. Awesome. Bob? Sword.
The sword, please.
Tell us, Bob.
All right.
What drives you to get up every day? Because if you're anything like me, you lay your head in the pillow at night, and the doubts, the fears, the worries, the concerns, the questions, am I covering all the bases of the T's crossed, the I's dotted, to make sure people are safe and everything's functioning well? But it's a lot. It's a lot. It's a lot.
There's a lot.
It's a lot.
It's a lot.
So what keeps you going?
As this week, you know, getting ready for camp to start actually this Sunday, you know, finishing up this week, all of the liability policy stuff that we've got to do with the insurers and being sure that you know, the jet skis and the boats are ready to roll and, you know, do we have all of our safe environment compliance in place? And it is a lot.
Yeah.
And I think that there's two things. For me, number one, I was sharing this with Aaron and Dan a little bit earlier, that, you know, after a week of camp, you know, you're exhausted. And it's a very good exhaustion, of course. But one of the things we do at camp on the last morning after our prayer lab, we give the kids the opportunity to stand up, and we have an open mic, and for them to share what they learned that week or how they were changed or transformed or what they're taking away. And I know every year I stand in the back of the room and I listen to those kids, you know, go up there on that stage and say, in adoration this week, I heard the Lord speak to me for the first time. Mm-hmm. This week, for the first time, I understand what my faith is about. This week, for the first time, I feel like I belong and that I'm accepted someplace. And that is the moment when I say, this is why we do this. This is why I can put up with all the other things that are important and essential, but this is why we do it. And the second piece, I think, for me personally, I go back to the story of, you know, Samuel and Eli, you know, and Samuel's, you know, hearing the voice of the Lord, thinking it's Eli, and ultimately, you know, Eli says to him, you know, go to the Lord and say, here I am, Lord. Mm. And that scripture has always had a special place for me because it is the handing over of myself, of ourselves, to God's will. Here I am, Lord. I come to do your will. And for whatever reason, he has seen fit to call me to do his will in this way by serving young people through Catholic Youth Summer Camp.
That's awesome. Gentlemen, great work. Keep it up. CYSC.com, ladies and gentlemen. We gotta encourage you to go out there and check it out. We got to support one another. We're all in this together. Gentlemen, thank you for your good work. And you'll be in our prayers. Please keep EWTN, Life on the Rock, and yours. And Father Mark, as only you can do, take us out.
Well, may our Heavenly Father shine his face upon you. May he give you his peace and send his Holy Spirit into your hearts. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We'll see you next week.